Out of nowhere and barely leaves you holding on. And when you're tired of fighting, chained by your control, there's freedom in surrender. Lay it down and let it go. So when you're on your knees and answers seem so far away, you're not alone. Stop holding on and just be here. Apart, it's falling into place. I'm on the throne, stop holding on and just be here. Just be here. Just be here. If your eyes are on the storm, you wonder if I love you still. If your eyes are on the cross, you know I always have and I always will. Then not a tear is wasted. In time you'll understand. I'm painting beauty with the ashes. Your life is in my hands.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Heritage Memorial Church. We're so glad you're here. If you're a visitor with us, we want you to know that if you're here checking us out as a church, hey, we'd love for you to connect with us this way. Just type the word or text the word welcome to that phone number. It's our way of connecting with you. You can connect with us and it begins the relationship. Maybe you'll get to ask some questions and so forth. And hopefully you'll understand that we just want to connect and find out what brought you our way. And thanks for coming. If you're a regular attender, say amen. Do you love your church? Say amen. Amen. Did anybody wake up with white stuff on your yard this morning? Okay, that's a God with a sense of humor. Just thought I'd tell you that. He is in charge, right? Everybody knows that? He is in charge. That I'm okay with that. Are you okay with that? He's in charge. All right, what do you say we fellowship? Come on up. Let's stand up and make some people welcome around you, okay?
Did we notice that this morning? Reason for praise in and of itself. And our songs are going to be all about praise today. I hope you came ready to sing praise and worship. We're going to sing God You Reign. We're going to sing Blessed Be the Name. But we're going to start with Beautiful One. So a whole bunch of songs about praise this morning. Let's all join in, sing along, clap our hands. Let's not be the church where you look funny at the one who claps and sings, but maybe the one who feels funny if you don't. Let's all praise God together this morning.
One, two, ready, aim. You captured my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you.
You've heard it, now everybody sing it, here we go.
Open my eyes to your wonders again. You captured my heart with this love, 'cause nothing on earth is as beautiful as you.
Yes.
So let's all do that this morning. We'll sing "Blessed Be Your Name" together. Here we go, Father Jason, you're on.
Blessed be your name.
The skies proclaim God you reign.
Second verse, part the seas.
You part the seas. You move the mountains with the words that you say. My soul remains. God, you reign. You hold.
Father, we come to you right now through the name of Jesus, Lord, and we thank you for this day, God. Lord, forgive us for making church repetitive, Lord. Sometimes my heart is grieved, Lord, when I'm up here, because I feel like we're missing it. I feel like I'm missing it. We come and we're spectators in your house. Forgive us, Lord. every Sunday we come before an all-powerful God and offer our worship and offer our praise and offer ourselves. And we give so little, so little. We go through the motions. We leave here tomorrow and we forget who we are. God, forgive us. God, help us. Help us to understand the seriousness of being a Christian. Help me to understand what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit and to live daily for you. Help us to smile. Help us to worship. Help us to praise you, Lord. And forgive us because we fall so short. Be with us today, Lord. I pray there will be a new awakening in our spirit, God. I pray, Lord, that you will lift us up. And I pray, God, that we will choose to be followers of you and understand what that means. 24/7, Lord, give us the strength. Forgive us. Forgive us for bringing you not what we should bring you, Lord. Help us to bring you our all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. If our ushers would come tonight, prepare us for the receiving of tithes and offerings. I want to remind you that we have a regular service this evening. Also, don't forget the Wednesday night electives have started. So those three classes are Becoming an Effective Parent in a Defective World, Spiritual Disciplines, and it's a leadership class called Five Levels of Leadership. Let's not forget why we exist. The candle is lit this morning. Easter Sunday morning, we saw over 24 people find Christ, make a commitment to Christ. So that's powerful, powerful stuff. And also, let me tell you something. Something happened in our 845 service a few weeks back where we actually had two individuals get very sick. We had to pray for them. And literally, it stopped the agenda of the service. And we moved right into a healing service. And somebody sent me an email this morning, where I read it this morning. And it said that somebody was healed of a major problem in our church that morning. And I want to let you know, God's still working. So the candle's lit because God is good all the time. Amen. So don't forget to jump and get involved in church. If you haven't got something that you're doing yet, we want you to know God can use you, and God can use you in big ways. So don't forget to stop in hospitality and talk to Connie Bowman. She will find something for you to do. And one of us will, but I know that she's got a great big heart. How many of you know Connie? Great big heart. So she's amen. So, Father, thank you so much for this moment that you've given us. It's our Sabbath. God, please, please touch this service. Be with us. And Lord, take these cheerful gifts that we offer from a cheerful heart. And Lord, touch the 22,000 unsaved people in this community. God, we need you. We love you. Be with us in Christ's name. Amen.
What? say.
As you can tell, our sermon series is Joseph. Before I get started, I got to tell you something. For those of you that have not experienced Louis Giglio, does anybody here know who Louis Giglio is? Would you raise your hands? He is one very intelligent, very cool communicator, and he has a book called The Comeback. Anybody here, this might be your book. This is a book. If there's anybody here who's thinking, man, I sure wish I could turn my life around and make a comeback. And this will help you with that. Of course, you put it with this book, and it becomes the duo, you know, that'll make that difference. God's Word is always the most important book you can pick up. But that book is, again, a great book. You will not be disappointed with that book. It's a great one. Also, Linda Miller wanted me to let you know that Fully Alive is fully on for tomorrow night. And so, ladies, don't forget. That's a good time. How many of you ladies enjoy Fully Alive? Say amen, wave your hand, scream and shout a little bit. All right. No screaming and shouting. It's okay. But let's go right into this idea. Genesis 37 is the passage that I'd like for you to turn to. And while you're turning there, let me just kind of make or ask this question. Can God use annoying people? No, now's not a good time to look at or point. Can God use annoying people? It's not a trick question. Can God use them? How many believe that? Now, don't give me your biblical answer. Give me your personal answer. How many of you know? How many know for a matter of fact? Well, in fact, let me give you an example. He's using me. Okay? So, yeah, you were pointing. I saw that. Again, can God use annoying people? In fact, let me ask another question, which might be a little more, I mean, because these two questions are actually very closely related with the life of Joseph. How many believe that God can use people even in their nightmares? Can God use you
Use people, use us in the middle of our nightmare. Be honest with you, I'm looking at people. I'm looking at people that God used you in this church in a low point, and God is still using you. That, you know, be honest with you, I could stop there if I could stop there and give an altar call, because I really believe some of us are convinced that because of the circumstances you're in a place you never planned to be. You don't like the place you're in, and you would like to see it change. The last thing you would think of is, hey, can God use me right here? And the statement is yes. God can use you. Even in the lowest place you have ever been, He can use you. Joseph, and in fact, a statement that can be said about his story is this: a man who had dreams that turned into nightmares on his way to a glorious place of God's will. So with that in mind, I just want you to know there's the first story we're going to talk about happens to be about those two things. You know, can God use annoying people? How many of you have read Joseph's story and know that he was an annoying child? Annoying child. And you all know this, annoying because he had arrogance and confidence, and not in a good way. And by the way, this is a lesson in itself. If you ever want to get control of arrogance and overconfidence, you got to put humility in the middle of it. If you put humility in the middle of it, it'll keep those in balance. In fact, C.S. Lewis made that statement. He said, too much confidence is bad. Too much arrogance is bad. If you put humility in the middle, it works. Here's what he says. Humility is the ability to be the greatest architect in the world and to build the most beautiful cathedral that ever existed, so that people who look at it weep tears of joy. He said, and then humility is the ability to be equally as happy if your neighbor builds it. See what I'm saying? That's so true. And humility ultimately was the tool that God used to place Joseph where he needed him. There's a lot of lessons we can learn from Joseph's life. And no doubt we all fit into some portion of his life. So let's strap on our minds and hearts and our souls and jump into those dreams. And yes, nightmares. Let's start with a few questions again beyond the others. What kind of person can God use to accomplish big things? Have you ever asked the question? What kind of person can God use to accomplish big things? And the second question, what are those qualifications of someone that God can impact masses of people? We've all had preconceived ideas of what God can and cannot use, and we have all stood at some point to cast judgment. You don't have to raise your hand and say, yes, Pastor. We have all done it. You can say amen, feel better about yourself. We've all judged people. We've all looked at people and said, God can't. I wonder if God could use that. Or I wonder, boy, what good is going to come out of that person? Remember, even in the New Testament, what good thing comes out of Nazareth? Little did they know, the greatest thing came out of Nazareth. And sometimes we're so quick to judge and say, God, not no. I mean, you got a real job if you can use that person. Let me just read a poem to you that this might relate to all of us. I dreamed death came the other night, and heaven's gates swung wide. With kindly grace and angel fair, he ushered me inside. And there to my astonishment stood folks I'd known on earth. Some I judged and labeled as unfit or those of little worth. Indignant words rose to my lips, but never were they set free. For every face showed stunned surprise. No one expected me. Amen. Just be, as quickly as we are to judge some people, understand maybe some people feel that way about you. So the family of Joseph wouldn't have exactly leaned on the idea that he had a lot to offer God. And he was a spoiled kid born to Rachel. Let's read some of those stories there in Genesis 37. You have your Bibles, 37, starting at verse 1. Now Jacob dwelt in the land where his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. This is the history of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brothers. And the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought a bad report of them to his father. Those words, bad report, I'm going to talk to you about in a second. Now Israel, that's Jacob, loved Joseph more than all of his children because he was the son of his old age. age. Also he made him a tunic of many colors. But when his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all the other brothers or his brothers, they hated him. That word hated is another word I'm going to bring up. And could not speak peaceably to him. Now Joseph had a dream, and he told it to his brothers, and they hated him even more. So he said to them, "Please hear this dream which I have dreamed. There we were binding sheaves in the field. Then behold, my sheaf arose, another stood upright. I stood upright, and indeed your sheaves stood all around and bowed down to my sheaf." And his brother said to him, "Shall you indeed reign over us? Or shall you indeed have dominion over us?" So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. Then he dreamed still another dream and told it to his brothers and said, "Look, I have dreamed another dream, and this time the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars bowed down to me." So he told it to his father and his brothers, and his father rebuked him. Even the one who loved him. "Really? Really? Were we supposed to bow down to you?" is what he says. And said to him, "What is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall your mother and I and your brothers indeed come to bow down to the earth before you?" God bless this message. But God use us. But Lord, before you can use us, sometimes you got to tune us up. Get us to realize that God, you want to use us, but there's things that have to be done. Search our hearts today, God. Talk to us about Joseph, but talk to us about us. We ask. And everybody said, Amen. Now Joseph 17, son of Jacob and Rachel. He's their miracle child. They were barren, and she bore Jacob two sons, died in the second birth with Joseph and Benjamin. And Jacob had two wives who were sisters. You remember that story? A lot of jealousy running around there. The nation of Israel is about ready to go into their 400 years of slavery to Egypt. Abraham mentioned it in Genesis 15. Little did Joseph know that he was going to play a starring role in this great big drama and picture. And he had a few problems. In fact, one guy put it this way. He was ahead of himself, sure of himself, and full of himself. Joseph was arrogant and immature. So how did Joseph turn it around? Okay, peek your ears up. Maybe there's somebody out here saying, how can I turn it around? How can I go from somebody who isn't liked, somebody who has made poor choices, somebody who really is in a place that they never intended to get? Maybe Joseph's story might have something for you today. And I think I know for a fact, if you're there, listen. And by the way, this isn't just for the people who are at the bottom. This is for everybody. How can God use me? You got to understand, I'm going to make a statement more than once, but you got to hear this. Arrogance is never at the top of the mountain of victory and triumph. You can't have it. God can't use arrogance. God can't use superiority mindedness. God needs humility. And with that in mind, we see Joseph's story and the lessons that we might learn from this man of God. And in fact, what are the lessons we should learn from Joseph that take us from confusion to understanding God's will? Now back to those questions. Can God use, or what kind of person does it take for God to use them? The first thing that I'd like to say this morning is that God is working on us even when our lives are self-centered. God can use the least likely candidates to accomplish His most wonderful results. When I typed that, I thought, that's our political circumstance. God, you're going to have to use the least likely. Didn't get any laughter, but I see a lot of heads nodding. There is no perfect candidate. And by the way, there is no perfect you. There is no perfect person among us. And today, when we think about Joseph, his life was destined for great things. Let's be honest, he had an ego, he was immature. And in just a few scriptures, in just a few first verses, we notice he was a spoiled kid. What would you have done if he was your brother? I mean, Joseph, he made a big fuss about his dreams, and he wore this coat of many colors, and his father gave it to him, so he's flaunting it, and he's on his brother's last nerve. And in other words, he was a little monster. And he was loved by his father, but a pest to everybody, almost. Look what he did, though. Here's the deal. The sons of Bilhah and Zilpah. Do you know who they are? I mean, just in case you haven't studied the story, you don't remember the story. These are sons born to Jacob and his wives' maids. So let's be honest. In a household of jealousy and hatred, on top of it, there's Joseph looking at the lower brothers. They're not really the brothers of the main moms. You know what I'm talking about? So here he has. And here's what it says. He's out in the field with those brothers, and he goes back to his dad and gives his dad a bad report. Okay. How many of you know what a tattletale is? Okay, now let me explain to you. Tattletales sometimes may actually have truthful things to say. That's not what that word means in Hebrew. The word in the Hebrew, bad report, means slander, unfair. It was literally untruthful. So he came back. Joseph, who's with the lower brothers, comes back to his dad and tells his dad a lie about his brothers. And then it says they really hated him. No kidding. So we have that. But then it says they hated him. That Hebrew word hate there literally means it's not the kind of hate that you have toward the Wolverines. It's a different kind. Okay? This did I say something funny? Oh. But this particular hatred is meant murderous intent of someone considered to be an enemy. They wanted him dead. He went back, lied, here he is. And the brothers come back and find out. Jacob talks to the brothers, obviously. The brothers find out that what they've said. And because of that, they want him dead. But what's even worse is, Joseph is oblivious. He's bragging about this dream and how he will someday have them bow before him. But God, listen, this is one of the most important points that you can hear this morning. God did not give him this gift for him. God did not give Joseph dreams and later on the interpretation of those dreams so he could brag about what gift he had. Because you know this and I know this, that the gift that God gave him ultimately would save the whole entire nation of Israel. Amen. You getting this? And not only would it save Israel, Egypt too. Right? I know maybe that's hard for you to swallow. But the fact is, Joseph received this gift that he's bragging about. You're going to be bowing before me. And he has no clue. He's oblivious. God gives this to him. He's too immature to figure it out. He's just a spoiled brat. Guys, can you think of somebody right now annoying? Okay, again, it's not inappropriate to look for or point at. Right now, get that person in your head that you're thinking of. And now tell this to yourself. God used Joseph. He started the process in the midst of his arrogance. The person that annoys you, God can use. Hey, Christians, it should change your perspective of the people that bug you. And by the way, how many of you have somebody in your life that bugs you? Come on. This God is watching. Somebody bug you? Say to yourself, God, help me to see that you can use those people. You can begin to do a work in that person. Maybe it should change the way you are praying. Instead of, God, get that jerk out of my life, God, help that jerk. We shouldn't be calling names, should we? God, please change that person. Despite what I think of them, use them. That's not a bad thing to think of. Shouldn't we Christians be the most optimistic, encouraging people in the world anyway? So here we have this situation, and God can take anyone and use them to accomplish His plan. But God cannot use them without first addressing self-centeredness and pride. How many of you have found out by now, and I'll be the first to raise my hand, how many of you found out that God has a way of shrinking big heads? Amen. Okay. And or humbling arrogant hearts. Is there anybody who would say, that was me? Thank you. Anybody else? I'm the first to tell you. I mean, I was the one that was running from God. I didn't want God in my life. My mom's tired of my mom beating it down my throat. Tired of my mom dragging me to church every Sunday. And Dad got to stay home and watch Bugs Bunny. That bugged me. It did. It bugged me that I couldn't stay home with Dad. I'm Bruce. His name is Bruce. I'm a junior. He's a senior. And for the longest time, I could not wait to get out of the house so that I could get out of that church and that whole environment that I was in. Yeah, I'm your preacher today. But guys, let me explain something to you. I was so arrogant and mouthy. Any other mouthy people here? Not necessarily now, but were you ever mouthy? It's a support group, okay? We can raise our hands. I had a big head. I thought I was headed on to big and great things and going in the Air Force and going to do this, going to do that. Let me tell you something. I went through some major nightmares in the process of God turning me into a man of God. You see, sometimes our life seems to be shaking only to find out it's God who's doing the shaking. You understand that? Now, that's not easy doctrine and theology to swallow. But you understand, not that God forces things on you, but when by our lifestyles we start backing off and we live in disobedient lives, He has to pull His hands off of us, and all of a sudden we find out that He allows those things to happen to get our attention. See? Oh, by the way, this week I found an illustration from South America. In South America, if they want to call somebody arrogant, they'll call them a llama. Anybody here farm llamas before? So get with me after the service, because tell me if this illustration is true. But I was reading yesterday that in South America, it's their metaphor for arrogance. And the reason why they say that is, they say you don't need a fence to keep llamas around. All you have to do is take one rope and walk around the llamas and put the rope just below their chins, between their chin and the bottom of their neck, because they're too proud to stoop under the rope. And again, let me make this statement to you. Arrogance and pride and self-centeredness cannot and will not be found on the mountain of triumph. Every one of us have got to have humility. Pray for it. You say, yeah, that's like patience, Pastor. You know, but the fact is, if you want to become something awesome and for God to use, you have got to decide, God, make me the kind of person that people are drawn to me, not because of my pride, talent, and skills, but because I have answers to problems that this world has, because I've found Jesus Christ. So, obviously, the first one, I mean, it's important that we understand God is working on us even when we live self-centered lives. But also, God is in charge when our abilities are inadequate. God can use the least likely and talented to accomplish what seems impossible. Now, if you read verses 18 through 37, you'll see Joseph's brother acting out of jealousy and greed, and they decide to take Joseph into their own hands, and so they have a plan. The plan starts out to kill him, but then, thank God, there's a brother that said, let's not do that. So then they went on to, then let's just let him starve in a cistern. They're going to throw him in a cistern. But then, of course, they ended up with, hey, why should we get rid of our brother and not make any money? Let's just go ahead and sell him. So they sold him into slavery. Let me tell you something. God is all powerful. Although we never find God's name mentioned in this entire chapter, His handiwork is all over the place in Joseph's story. Even though bad things began to happen to Joseph, God allowed them to happen in order to transform him into someone that God could use. He was not as important as he thought, he found out. He was not as intelligent as he thought. He was not as indispensable as he thought. He would soon learn enough that his dreams were in need of maturing and interpreting was that part. You know, the dreams didn't get him to the big show. It was the interpretations. You see, there was no interpretations ahead of time. It was as he learned in the low moments, the nightmares, that he gained what he needed to gain. God had given Joseph those dreams, but that those interpretations had to develop that gift in the difficult places. Don't miss the lessons you're supposed to learn in these moments. If you're in a nightmare, if you're in difficulties right now, and if you should very soon find yourself in difficulty, these are points you need to hear. God can take your nightmare and turn something beautiful out of it. Now you say, Pastor, how can you say that? Because I've had a handful of nightmares. Maybe they're not your nightmares, and maybe they're not as tough and difficult as your nightmares. But all I'm saying is this, I've been in ministry long enough to see God touch people in difficulty to use them. This is not fake. This is not a facade, guys. God wants some of you. And here's what I have to believe. There are some people here in this room that are in the middle of a nightmare. And in it, look for the Lord. Because He's there. He is. And don't miss the lessons you're supposed to learn in these moments. God can teach us powerful things after we have made poor choices. People may try to judge you, but our great God wants to use you. Learn to be patient. You know what the definition of patience is to a believer, right? It is the ability to remain calm in the midst of turmoil because you know God is in control. Amen. Number three, God is preparing us even when our lives are isolated. Verse 37, you'll see here that now the Midianites had sold him in Egypt to Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh and a captain of the guard. You see, God can prepare you for great things from the place that you never planned to be. Now, let me give you an illustration to try to bring it together of how God can take a difficult thing. And this is an illustration that I'll play off of. It's an illustration of an unhappy princess. This unhappy princess was unhappy because she was not beautiful in her own eyes. She was afraid of what people would think and call her and tell her, even though she was a princess. So she called and these experts to try to find out, I need to figure out how to make myself beautiful. And nobody was able to create the circumstances by which she felt that she was beautiful. So her great aunt comes along and she says, honey, I can tell you, there's three things that come to making you beautiful. So she started practicing those three things. And pretty soon people started treating her different. And after a while, she had become so beautiful that women all over the nation were coming to ask her, how did you become so beautiful? And her response was, well, let me tell you what my great aunt told me. These three things. Here they are. Number one, smile at everyone you meet. Number two, look for all the beautiful things you can find. And third, say something kind to everyone. See, her goal was, and I don't need to go any farther, especially for you ladies, get the intent here. So many of us worry about this. Amen? You know, I mean, the fact is, do you miss our teenagers? They're not here today. They're at the retreat. And I'm just praying that God will do a big work on them. But some of those young girls are so concerned about their looks, and having the right hair, and having the most, the coolest clothes. But let me tell you something. That mentality, if played into the 60s, 50s and 60s, becomes so shallow. Why? Because exterior beauty doesn't last. Amen. So what she found out as the unhappy princess was this. People are more in tune to seeing the transformation that happens inside of you. I'm going to tell you something. I have met some beautiful people that are not exactly the best looking people in the world. Go ahead and laugh. It may be you. And I know this. I don't look like I did. I actually had decent looks at one time. But let me tell you something. Here's what I learned from my mother. Son, you become a man of God. If you treat people well and you become a man of God, you will be liked. Amen. And you'll have friends. And sometimes we get in these places that we never intend to be. And we say, oh God, you got to get me out of here. God, you got to help me with this job. You got to help me with this spouse. Or you got to help me with this boyfriend or girlfriend. Or God, you got to help me with this. And God's saying, would you please let me have it?
Amen.
Let me touch you. Let me bless you. Because let me tell you something. You agree. I know you agree with me. What's inside of a person's heart can make them so much more beautiful than they ever thought they could become. Because that's what God wants to do. He wants to work in here. And in your difficult place, the bottom line is, and maybe people don't want to hear this, but Joseph's brothers, before I go any farther, I know that there's going to be some Bible scholars here that are going to disagree with what I'm saying, but give me a second. Okay? I might pull it off. Joseph's brother did him a favor. You want to know why? If they hadn't done what they had done, he would have still remained in Canaan. And the famine would have come, and the family would have starved. Okay? Even though Joseph didn't like how it played out, the fact is, they did him a favor. He went from what was going to ultimately be famine and starvation. His brothers saved. And you know the end of the story. Let me go ahead and give it to you. When the brothers finally come, the ones who wanted him dead to begin with finally come in front of him. He pulls them off makes everybody leave the room, and he cries and says, you intended this for bad, but God made something good come out of it. Listen, your nightmare, your difficulty right now, you may think this is the devil and this is and this is that, and that person did this and this job did this and this boss did that. You say it was intended for your harm. Stop.
Amen.
And look up.
Yeah.
And say, God, turn it into beautiful. Turn it into beautiful. Joseph was mistreated, victimized, sold by his brothers. But God delivered, transformed, and improved him. And over the next 13 years, up to Genesis 41, he had no one but God to rely on. But that's exactly what he needed. To rely on God. When we end up in places we never intended or planned to be, God can take that experience and use it to transform us, to take you a little higher. Let me just kind of tell you something. You've already heard this, but I think it's worth bearing again. God doesn't call people who are qualified. He calls people who are willing, and then He qualifies them. So you can trust God through the nightmares. Let me just kind of quickly hit this again. Trusting God in your nightmares. Listen to these things. God delivers us from more than just ourselves. So look around. God delivers us from more than just ourselves. If you're out there saying, I need God to deliver me from this. For what other reason than you should He do it? It's not a happy statement, is it? But He loves me. But do you love Him enough to let your circumstances turn into His glory? Know this, the difficulty you're in is not just going to happen in deliverance for just you. Look around. Because somebody might need. Bobby, can I use your situation? He and Connie have been through a whole lot. Man, I love those guys. But how many people have been touched by His life since? Amen? So, and let me tell you something. The good news is, He's the exact example I'm talking about. Someone who's saying, I'm going to... Do you know what His first words were when He came back to consciousness? Do you know what it is? I love Jesus. That was the first words He had. Right, Connie? I mean, he was still in his drug-induced stupor, and all he could say was, I love Jesus. And he has proven it ever since.
Amen.
Guys, there are a whole lot of Bobbies around. People who have been through nightmares who said, God, this is on you. I'm going to trust you. So God, show me. Show me who else needs to learn and to be blessed as you deliver me from this circumstance. And number two, God delivers us only after the lessons have been learned. So look within you. Let me tell you something. When we get into nightmares and bad situations, we need to understand God still has something to tell us. So you keep praying, you keep digging until God finally shows you what that lesson is. So look within you. If you're in a nightmare, look within you. Don't look out at that person or that thing or that circumstance that got you into this nightmare. Stop it, stop it, stop it. Look inside of you and say, God, I can't do this. So I need to hear from you. Show me, talk to me, teach me. You guys know this. This is stuff that's not brand new to you. You're probably saying, move on, we got this. So look within you. And also, if you're in a nightmare, learn this. God delivers us to become more intimate with us. He delivers us so we can become more intimate with Him. So look above you. Amen. Look up. Look up. God wants to deliver you, and in the process, the two of you get tight. Let me close with a story from somebody you might know. As soon as I read a story, you probably pick it off who it is. But let me just read it. He was born in Columbus, Ohio in 1890. You got it? Have you figured it out yet? Columbus, 1890. Okay, let me move on a bit. Okay, he was the third of eight children. At 11, he quit school because the family needed him to work at 11. So he then went and got a job, and he was making a full $3.50 a week. At 15, he got interested in automobiles and went to work at a garage, making a dollar more, $4.50. He knew he would never get anywhere without more schooling, so he just subscribed to a correspondence home study course. I didn't know they even had those back in the early 1900s. The boy, so sure enough, he got into a home study course on automobiles. Night after night, he'd work all day at the garage, then he would go to the kitchen table at the light of a kerosene lamp, and he just believed he had faith in his future. His next step was already planned. He decides to go to one of the biggest automobile companies in Columbus. Anybody here remember the Freyer Miller Automobile Company? No hands. You must not have been alive at that time. The Freyer Miller Automobile Company, when he felt he was ready, he went into the plant, and the first guy he finds is under the hood of a car. His name is Lee Freyer. He's the founder of the company. So he just kind of stands there. And so Freyer looks at him and says, yes, can I help you? He said, yeah, I just want to let you know I'm going to start working here. He said, really? Who hired you? He said, no one, but I'll be here first thing in the morning. So Freyer just kind of blew him off, and he continued to work. Well, the next morning, sure enough, he woke up, got up, went to the Freyer Miller Automobile Company, and he walked in, and Freyer wasn't there, and anybody who hires was not there. So he just kind of stood around, and he saw that there were metal shavings and oil and grease all over the floor. So he decides to get a broom and a shovel, and he starts cleaning the place up. You know the end of this story. Freyer shows up, sees what he did, hires him. Do you know who this kid became? Well, first of all, he was known as a race car driver. And he also was somebody who became an automobile expert. He was in World War I, became America's leading flying ace. You got it now? Later, he founded Eastern Airlines. His name was Eddie Rickenbacker. Anybody ever heard of him? Eddie Rickenbacker. Let me explain something to you. Why am I using an illustration of some kid cleaning up metal shavings? Because he didn't let his poverty keep him from having faith in his future. If you're here this morning, you know, I got to confess, I got to tell you, I've watched a handful of you wipe tears this morning. And I don't know what you're going through. And all I can say is this, whatever you're in, don't let the current issues keep you from knowing that tomorrow and the years to come can be even better. God can take your situation. I'm not saying it's going to happen overnight. It may not even happen in 5 years. But I know this, I think my God is big enough to touch your situation. Do you? See, do you? See, can God, or do you have faith in your future? If God is on your side, you can have faith in your tomorrows. No matter where you're at now. No matter what nightmare you're in. But see, first and foremost, you gotta make Him Lord first. How are you ever going to win the arrogance confidence issue? How are you ever going to get out of the comparison deal where you're better than somebody? You got to make Him the Lord of your life. And that's done by the ABCs. Admit the fact that you're a sinner. Believe that Christ came to save you. Confess your sin and God will save you. Now that's number one. But number two is you got to trust God with what you're in. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Is that still in the scripture? How many of you have struck that one from your Bible? I mean, you pulled a Jefferson thing. You cut out. Now, who would cut that one out? Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. What is that trying to tell us? First of all, if He's the Lord of my life, I just got to be patient and wait. And serve Him. And last but not least, you got to just believe that there's faith for your future. Trust Him with your future. It's why He sent His Son. He sent His Son to save you, but guess what? Save means more than just conversion. How many of you believe God saved you to use you? God saved you to use you. So if you're saved but doing nothing for Him, man, you've got like the whole catalog to look through. What can I do? So often when we're in our nightmares, we only see the nightmare. If you could just take the devil's movie screen and move it just a little bit and look past it all, God's there. And God is working. God will help you. But you got to trust Him. Would you stand, please? With Rita playing the piano, just bow your heads, close your eyes. Please, nobody looking around. Is there anybody out there that would say, Pastor, I want to tell you that I'm not in a good place right now. I need somebody to pray for me. I sure would like for you to pray for me. Would you raise your hand? Hands are going up already. Anybody just raise? Thank you. Thank you. In a nightmare, huh? Yeah, praise God. More of you wiping tears. Put your hands down. You can look up now. I'm old school, and I don't apologize for that. I still believe in altars. I still believe that people can step out and allow other people to pray for them. And they can give it to God. I also know it can happen at your pew. But we are talking about eternity. We're talking about your nightmare. We're talking about your difficulties. Of the many hands just went up, would any of you just say, I want to step out. I want to pray about this. We will make sure somebody prays with you. Anybody want to step out? Come on. Bunch of you. Come on. Bunch of you had your hands up. Come on. This is your way. Come on. This is your way of saying, God, I give it to you. Take this nightmare. Do something good and big in my life. Amen. Still coming. Praise God. Anybody else want to come? Carmen, would you mind? I want my wife to come up and pray our final prayer. But before she prays, what do you say, those of you that don't necessarily feel like you need to be praying today, would you mind joining my wife and praying for the people around you? There were so many hands that went up, somebody near you raised your hands. pray for him, will you? Join her as she prays.
Dear Jesus, what a privilege to be here this morning and to hear from your word and to learn from the story of Joseph and how many times we've gone through things and trials that we don't understand because we can't see that big picture. And God, I know this morning, just from what Bruce said, with the many, many hands that were raised, there are many troubled hearts among us. Our brothers and sisters are in a place where they're maybe full of doubt or full of fear or full of hurt, maybe even anger or bitterness. And God, they're just needing wisdom from you. They need your touch, they need your peace, and they need to sense your love this morning. So we pray for them that you will just give them that hug that they need this morning from you, that they will sense that you are a real God who cares for them, and that what Satan wanted to use for harm or for bad, that you can make something good come out of it, that a testimony can come from it that can bring glory to you. God, I pray for wisdom for each of us, that we will know how to respond. As I read Proverbs, and it's just full of giving us advice on seeking your wisdom, seeking your rules, seeking your word and your guidance, and to follow our to align our steps with you and follow you, that you will bless our lives. So I pray that we will each do that, that we will be obedient to your word, that we will follow you in everything that we do and say, so that we can enjoy the blessings and the wisdom that you will give us abundantly. God, I pray that today will be a day, a new day, that we can walk out of here. Maybe not every problem will be solved, but we will have a Savior who will walk with us through those problems and through those valleys, that we can have the beauty of confidence, knowing we are loved by you, Jesus, and that there's no harm that can come to us without coming through you first. So we're going to trust you with our life. We're going to be obedient and live for you, and we're going to give every blessing and turn it back to praise to you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.